Welcome to the next lecture in this course on signals and systems. So till the last lecture we were talking about the basic properties of signals, the basic operations on signals, and we had seen that the basic operations consist of the shifting, scaling and time reversal operations. Now we have seen the basic operations which are performed on the unit step, unit ramp signals, and the combination of these type of signals were also seen. Okay, so now what we will do in this lecture, we will try to have some problems based on the properties of the continuous time unit impulse signal. Okay, so in the starting lectures we discussed some of the properties which are present in the unit impulse signal, like the shifting property, the scaling property was also there. Okay, so based on those properties we'll here try to solve some problems. Okay, so the first question is integral minus 2 to 1 t plus t square del of t minus 3 dt. Okay, so the question is you have to evaluate this integral by using the properties of the impulse signal. Okay, so quickly you can just recall the shifting property of the impulse signal, and from there you can see that the impulse is located at t equals to 3. Okay, it is written as del t minus 3. That means the impulse is located at the location t equals to 3, because this is the shifted version of the impulse signal, and the limits of the integral is given from minus 2 to 1. Okay, so the location at which this impulse is located, that is this t equals to 3, this is not in the interval, this is not in the interval which is given in the integral. Okay, so the integral limit is given from minus 2 to 1, so this t equals to 3 is not in this interval of minus 2 to 1. So just by using that shifting property of the impulse signal, you can directly write this integral equal to 0. Okay, so this is what we have seen in the shifting property, that if this value is not in this interval, you can directly write it as 0. Okay, now similarly the second problem is okay, so minus 2 to 4 t plus t square del t minus 3 dt. So this is the same problem as above, but the limits are now changed. Okay, so now you can see that this limits minus 2 to 4, now it covers this t equals to 3 point. Okay, so again just by using the shifting property you can write, that means the value of this integral will be simply you substitute t equals to 3 in it. Okay, so this will come out to be 12. Okay, so this is how these type of problems will be salt. Now coming to the next problem, you have to evaluate this integral, which is given as t square plus cos pi t del t minus 1 dt. Okay, so now the limits are from minus infinity to infinity, so obviously it will cover this t equals to 1 as well. So the value of this integral will simply be replacing t with the value as plus 1. So this will give you t square plus cos pi t in brackets, and substitute t equals to 1. So what it will give you is 1 plus cos pi, that will be equal to 1 minus 1, that will be 0. Okay, now similarly one more problem. E raised to the power t minus 2 with the limit 0 to 3 and multiplied by del of 2t minus 4 dt. Okay, now this problem is slightly different from the above problems which we had just discussed. This will actually involve two different properties which are discussed for the continuous time unit impulse signals. It will employ the scaling as well as the shifting property of the impulse signal. Okay, so if I write it as e raised to the power t minus 2 del of 2t minus 4 dt equals to 0 to 3 e raised to the power minus t minus 2 del of twice t minus 2, this is simple rearranging, just take common 2, so this expression will then become e raised to the power minus t minus 2, and then at this step you can employ the scaling property of the impulse signal. Okay, so this step will become something like this, and then in the last step you can simply obtain the integral value by replacing t equals to 2. Okay, so if you replace t equals to 2 in this, so 2 minus 2 will become 0, this will become 1 by 2 e raised to the power 0. Okay, that will be equal to 1 by 2. So this will be the final answer. Okay, so we can see one more problem here. Which will employ both the properties. The question is e raised to the power minus t del of 2t minus 2 dt. Okay, so again you have to evaluate this. So again you will use the properties of shifting and scaling. So So this shifting and scaling properties are actually the properties of the impulse signal, which we had discussed while discussing the impulse signal. Okay, so you do not get confused by the shifting and scaling, which we had just finished before starting this lecture. Okay, so that is different. So this will become e raised to the power minus t del of twice t minus 1. Again you can take 2 common here, so that you can employ the scaling property in this step. So this will be 1 by 2 del of t minus 1 dt equals to 1 by 2 e raised to the power minus t equals to 1. Okay, so we are putting t equals to 1, so this will become, or it can also be written as this. Okay, so these are some problems related to the continuous time unit impulse signal. Now we come on to the another topic in the our discussion. We have to discuss some elementary signals which are very frequently used in the while studying about the signals and systems. And these elementary signals, they very occur frequently in the different applications, and they also serve as a basis for the representing other signals. Okay, so the first one of it is the real exponential signal. Okay, the first one of this is the real exponential signal. So a real exponential signal generally has a form of expression of this type, C e raised to the power at. Okay, where this C and this A, they both are real parameters. Okay, so they both will be real. That is why this is called real exponential signal. Okay, so this parameter C is actually the amplitude of the exponential signal, which is measured at time t equals to 0. On the other hand, the value of this parameter A, it will decide that whether the exponential will be a growing exponential or it will be a decaying exponential. Okay, so if the value of A is greater than 0, that means it is positive, then the exponential will be a growing exponential. It will be a growing exponential. Whereas on the other hand, if A is less than 0, that means it is negative, then the exponential will be a decaying exponential. Okay, so this is the difference between these two. Okay, so if I quickly plot the waveforms for both these type of signals, so this is how a growing exponential will look like, and this will be the decaying type of exponential. Okay, so this will be the value of constant C. Okay, similarly this is the value of C. So this graph, it represents a decaying exponential, that means the value of A is negative, whereas this graph is a growing exponential where the value of this small a is greater than 0. Okay, so this was actually continuous time exponential signal, because the variable is continuous in this case, that is why it is the continuous time real exponential signal. Okay, next we move on to the discrete time exponential signal. So the real exponential signal, it can be a continuous time exponential signal or it can be a discrete time exponential as well. Okay, so for discrete time exponential signal, so I should quickly write it as that was actually continuous time exponential signal. Okay, continuous time exponential signal, that is the A part, you can say, of the real exponential signal, whereas in this part, this will be the B part for it, the discrete time exponential signal. Okay, so the discrete time exponential signal will have the form as C R raised to the power n. Okay, so again this C and R, they will be real parameters. Okay, because this is a real exponential signal, or sometimes this expression is alternately written as C e raised to the power a n or alpha n. Okay, whatever it be, we can also denote it with alpha. Okay, where R equals to e raised to the power alpha. Okay, so again, if the magnitude of R is greater than 1, so this will be a growing exponential curve. Okay, this will be a growing exponential curve, whereas if the value of R is less than 1, then we will have a decaying exponential. Okay, so the things are very much same as compared to the continuous time. The only difference is the variable, which is discrete here. Okay, that is why it is called the discrete time. So if I just plot, so this is how discrete time exponential might look like. Okay, so if you can see, the amplitude is increasing. Okay, so this is a growing exponential. Similarly, for the decaying exponential, the amplitude will be decreasing in this way. Okay, so you can see here the amplitude is decreasing in this case. So you can denote it by this xn, since this is the discrete time signal. Okay, so this is growing exponential, this curve, and this curve will be the decaying exponential. Okay, now move on to the next signal. Now we discuss the complex exponential signals. First of all, we discuss the real exponential signal. Now we quickly discuss the complex exponential signals. Okay, so the general form of a complex exponential signal, it is xt equals to e raised to the power j omega naught t. So this is a complex exponential signal. Okay. So in the complex exponential signal, this parameter c, which was discussed in previous case, so this parameter c or parameter a or both of them, they can assume complex values. Okay, so the exponential will become complex and we call it as the complex exponential signal. So again, it can be the continuous time complex signal or it can be a discrete time complex exponential signal. So first let us consider this continuous time case. So this is a complex exponential signal. Okay, now when we were discussing the periodicity of the signals, the periodic and aperiodic signals, where we have discussed, you may recall that we discussed that this signal is actually periodic. This e raised to the power j omega naught t is a periodic signal. Okay, so this is the property which is already discussed of this signal. Okay, and we know that the fundamental period t naught will be equal to 2 pi over omega naught for this particular signal. Okay, now this was the continuous time. If we talk about the discrete time part of this complex exponential, the discrete time signal can be represented as e raised to the power j omega naught n. Okay, so again there is one thing about this complex exponential signal. You can see here that, let us suppose, if for frequencies omega naught plus 2 pi in place of omega naught, you place omega naught plus 2 pi, if you write it as, so this will become e raised to the power j 2 pi n. Okay, you can simplify it. The plus sign will not be here, it will be multiplication. So it will be multiplication e raised to the power j omega naught n. Okay, so you must know from your previous knowledge that this signal will always be 1. Okay, because you can apply the Euler's rule, which you might know. Okay, so you can also see that this will be always 1 and this will be equal to then e raised to the power j omega naught n. So what we conclude from here is that the exponential at the frequency omega naught plus 2 pi is the same as that as the frequency omega naught. Okay, so this is the difference between the discrete time and continuous time exponential. In the continuous time exponential signals, e raised to the power j omega naught t, they all are distinct for distinct values of omega naught. Okay, whereas here in case of discrete time, we had seen that the exponential at frequency omega naught plus 2 pi is the same as that frequency omega naught. Okay, so periodicity already we had discussed before also when we were discussing the periodic and aperiodic signal. We had seen that this signal will be periodic if omega naught over 2 pi, that will be equal to m over n. Okay, so that can be also seen from the previous lecture. We have already discussed it. Okay, now coming to the next topic, so rather the next signal, we were discussing some elementary signals. So we discuss the exponential signal, the real and the complex exponential signals. Okay, next special type of signal or function can be a signum function. Okay, so you might be familiar with this. So this is written as signum t equals to 1 for t greater than 0, it is 0 for t equals to 0, and it is minus 1 for t less than 0. So this is the signum function. It is denoted by this short form SGN. Okay, so it can also be written in terms of the unit step signal. So now you already know about the unit step signal. So this signum function can be written in terms of the unit step signal in this form, minus 1 plus twice of ut, where this ut denotes the unit step signal. Okay, so the waveform of signum function will something look like this. Okay, so this is signum function, this is 1, this is minus 1. Okay, so this is all about this signal. Next type of the elementary signal is the sampling function. Okay, now what is this sampling function? It is defined as sampling signal equals to sine t over t. Okay, so since you can see that the denominator is an increasing function of t and the numerator is bounded, because you know that sine t, the magnitude of sine t, it will be equal to less than equal to 1 magnitude. Okay, so this actually sampling function is a damped sine wave, and it is an even function of t which will have its peak at t equals to 0 and the zero crossing at t equals to plus minus n pi. So I will draw the sampling function waveform. So this waveform will be something look like this. It is also given in the book, you can see for better clarity. Okay, so this will be sampling function. It will have the peak at t equals to 0 and the zero crossings at pi, 2 pi. Similarly, this will be minus pi, this will be minus 2 pi. Okay, one more variant you can say of this sampling function is defined as the sync function. Okay, sync function. So sync, it is called sync function. It is defined as sine pi t over pi t. Okay, so it can also be written in this form of the sampling function. So these two signals are interrelated actually. So if I draw the waveform of sync function, okay, let me draw in a straight line. Okay, so this waveform will also look like that of a sine wave. You can draw it something like this. Okay, so this will be the waveform for sync signal. This is 1, this amplitude will be 1, maximum value at t equals to 0, and this will be 1, and then 2, 3, and so on. Okay. This will be minus 1, this will be minus 2, minus 3, and so on. Okay. So this is the sinc function. So we have just discussed these signals. Now in the coming units, wherever these signals will be used, then you will be able to see that how these signals are actually used there. Okay, so things will get more clear as we will use them in some problems. Okay, so obviously they will be we will use them in some of the coming lectures or coming units. Okay, so with this much we stop for today. Now we have almost covered all the things related to signals, and from the next class we will start the systems. Okay, thank you very much.